So it stood in 1984 when I wrote The Murder Guide to London and for the first time visited the Ripper sites and read a lot of police memoirs. Now, I approach a historical mystery as a historian and not a Sherlock. I don't ask who done it. I ask what documents are there, who thought they knew at the time, and how reliable and well-informed were they. By this test, the police on the ground seemed prima facie the most likely to be on the right trail. They were at the cutting edge of the investigation. They knew the district. The top brass depended on their reports to draw their conclusions. And all writers agreed that the top brass at Scotland Yard were at sixes and sevens, squabbling over office politics and contradicting each other. McNaughton for Druitt, Anderson for a Polish Jew, Smith and Abilene against both these solutions. The police on the ground all seemingly suspected some doctor. Spicer accused one. White allegedly encountered a middle-class man with a cultivated voice. Ben Leeson, a constable on the Francis Coles investigation, said that H Division CID always suspected a certain local doctor who was usually in the vicinity of the crimes. But reading the memoirs proved a revelation. The police on the ground were totally unreliable. Leeson's story was contradicted by the evidence at the inquest. The story ascribed to Stephen White was obviously drawn from Sergeant Badham's experience of checking constables on duty at Castle Alley, the only Ripper-related site which approximates to the description given. Spicer's story of the one that got away had never really convinced anybody. The one policeman on the ground who wrote an unvarnished account of the investigation was Walter Dew, a detective constable in 1888. And he said he had no idea who the murderer was, but didn't think he could have been middle class, as police arrested anybody inappropriately dressed for visiting the slums. Major Smith of the City Police also proved utterly unreliable. Despite his claim to know more about the murders than any man living, his anecdotal material was quite incompatible with the evidence given at inquests. He claimed, for example, to have been 5 minutes away from catching the Ripper when he found a public sink of bloody water draining away outside Dorset Street, where the murderer washed his hands. Yet he contradicted himself as to whether this was on the night of the double murder or the morning of Mary Jane Kelly's, and in either case, his recorded movements showed that he must have been at least 4 hours behind the Ripper, who could not have left the bloody water. But the despised Scotland Yard top brass looked surprisingly reliable. Dew recalled Chief Inspector Moore as heading the case, with Abilene only an important officer. McNaughton, surely in the best position to know, named Swanson. I mentally downgraded Abilene's importance and wondered what Swanson might have known. Nobody at that time knew of his statement in 1895 that the Ripper had died. Nobody had seen the document placing him in charge of the case. But the real revelation was the reliability of Dr. Robert Anderson. Matters and Rumbelow had dismissed him as sour, grapesily accusing Pizer. But this was manifestly not the case. Anderson's suspect went to an asylum. Pizer didn't. Odell had insinuated, and Knight had positively asserted, that Anderson's claim to knowledge was empty boasting, if not downright lying. But a study of Anderson showed that this was impossible. Anderson was first and foremost a devout, if cranky, millenarist Christian. I had myself been brought up in the far reaches of dissent, and knew intimately the kinds of integrity and dishonesty to be found there. And the sort of public lying ascribed to Anderson was utterly out of the question for such a man. Nor was Knight's claim true that nothing written by any other policeman supported him. McNaughton did name a suspect, the Polish Jew Kosminski, who fitted Anderson's claim. Only Whitechapel was full of foreign Jews, and Kosminski was not an especially uncommon name. I doubted if he could be traced. I had no plan to trail Jack the Ripper. I planned to write a coffee table book, bringing together all the photographs and illustrations relating to the case, with a short text describing the murders, the police involved, and the major theories. With the conclusion that a search of asylum records, if they had survived, should lead to a Whitechapel Jewish lunatic named Kosminski, who would be a more plausible suspect than any hitherto named. My agent sent the proposal around publishers, and in February 1986 telephoned me to say that Weidenfeld and Nicholson wanted it, but at greater length, without the pictures, and with the suspect traced. Since they were sure my argument for Anderson's reliability and the identity of his suspect with McNaughton's Kosminski must be correct. They wanted the manuscript complete within 9 months. My first approach was to local history libraries and archives to see whether asylum records had survived. They had, I was told, but I should not be allowed to see them, as they were sealed with a strict 100-year embargo. There could be no hope of tracing the Ripper from them for the centenary of his murders. So I checked the death registers, looking for anyone with a name like Kosminski or Kaminski or Kosmansky, variants to be found in Farson and McCormick, who had died in Frean, where Coney Hatch Asylum took most North London lunatics, Ewell, where the South London lunatics were held, or Berkshire, where Broadmoor still holds convicted mental patients. No luck. Then I noticed a remark of Stephen Knight's. Although asylum records were closed, workhouse infirmary records were open, and poor lunatics went via them to the major asylums. I went to the Whitechapel workhouse infirmary records looking for a Kosminski. There was none. But on the 24th of March, 1888, Nathan Kaminski, a 23-year-old Polish-Jewish bootmaker of Black Lion Yard, had gone to Whitechapel workhouse infirmary, where he was diagnosed syphilitic and treated for 6 weeks. His ward contained no bedfast cases, so he was almost certainly an outpatient or free to come and go during the day. Kaminski was not only well within the range of 1880s clerical error for Kosminski, it was one form of the name given by Daniel Farson. I wrote to Farson immediately, asking the source of this form. He replied courteously, regretting that the loss of his Ripper file meant that he no longer knew. Today, having seen the Aberconway document, I realised that Farson was very responsibly transcribing a name whose first syllable was rendered illegible by the damaged paper. What was especially exciting was the address. Black Lion Yard ran south off Old Montague Street between Brick Lane and Bucks Row. It opened out onto the Whitechapel Road directly opposite Plumber's Row, near which Leather Apron was said to have lived. And Plumber's Row ran in a straight line down to Berners Street, Long Liz Stride's otherwise out-of-the-way murder site in St. George's in the East Parish, south of Whitechapel Road. Black Lion Yard was close to the centre point of the five Ripper murders. The Goulston Street doorway, where the Ripper dropped his only clue, was directly in line with it as one left Mitre Square. A murderer fleeing there from Bucks Row would not have encountered P.C. Neal coming along Winthrop Street or P.C. Mizen coming down Hanbury Street. The Ripper's often alleged near-magical knowledge of Whitechapel alleys became the obvious good luck of following direct routes if he lived off Old Montague Street. In fact, Black Lion Yard is still the only address associated with any Ripper suspect that fits every known topographical detail of the murders. And topography supplies the only true physical clues that have survived. As a bootmaker, Kaminski would have owned a leather apron. Journalist Philip Loftus had written to Lady Aberconway that he had seen a draft of the McNaughton memoranda in her nephew Gerald Melville Donner's possession in 1950, and this said that the Polish Jew suspect was Leather Apron. There was another, more tenuous clue. I had already discovered the murder of Ada Wilson on March the 28th and wondered whether this was the inexperienced handiwork of the Ripper. Coming 4 days after Kaminski learned he had syphilis, it seemed to support the plausible police theory that the crimes began when the murderer, as was quite common at the time, sought violent revenge against a woman who had poxed him, discovering in the process that such violence was in itself gratifying. Could Kaminski have assaulted Ada Wilson, and then drawn back cautiously to the leather apron phase of mere threats and blows for fear of being caught, as Ada's assailant so nearly had been, until, at the end of August, he discovered that Polly Nichols passed out when he grabbed her throat and squeezed, leaving her, like her successors, helpless at his mercy. I thought so then, and I think so now. But I am the first to concede that I have not proved it. Equally persuasive, almost, was the fact that Abilene's ultimate suspect was exactly the same age as Kaminsky, was another Pole, though a Gentile, and had, to English ears, a similar name. Had Abilene remembered that a young Polish immigrant with a name like Kosumpfingski had been among the suspects he was urgently briefed to trace? About this time I contacted Richard Whittington Egan. He knew Whitechapel well enough to know that Black Lion Yard was an astonishingly plausible location for the Ripper's lair. He was also delighted to learn that a suspect from among the immigrant community had turned up, and he urged me to carry on the good work. My job now was to find what became of Nathan Kaminsky, and I failed utterly. He was not on the English or Welsh death registers. As a man with no financial means, treated at the public charge in the infirmary, he would not have gone to the legal expense of changing his name by deed poll. The Jewish Board of Guardians would not help such a man to emigrate unless he had skills, relatives, and a job to go to. Kaminsky, as a matter of record, had no known relatives. And neither he, nor anybody with a similar name or matching his description, had gone into any other East End or City Workhouse infirmary between 1888 and 1890. Like Leather Apron, Nathan Kaminsky just vanished. And then the staff of the Greater London Archives realized that I was researching very seriously, and they told me that I might well be given access to asylum records before the 100-year embargo was up. They gave me addresses to write to, and with most of my book written and bare weeks to go before the delivery date, I was at last able to find out how all the poor Jewish lunatics whose names I had collected had fared. Only the asylum records didn't give me a Kaminsky either. The last records to reach me were the most important. Coney Hatch, the main London mental hospital north of the Thames, and quite the most likely to have taken Kosminski. I was given the men's day book, with notes on all cases from 1885 to 1890. And no Kaminsky, no bootmaker, no man with a leather apron occurred among the handful of poor Jews from Whitechapel. Until it suddenly dawned on me. From the point of view of the ending of the murders, the most likely patient had always been a Whitechapel Jew named David Cohen, sent from Thames Magistrates Court to the infirmary on December the 7th, transferred to Coney Hatch 2 weeks later, dying in the asylum the following year. Only his name was Cohen, not Kaminsky. He was a tailor, and not in a leather-aproned occupation. And his address was not in the heart of the district, as McNaughton had suggested, but away to the west of the parish at 84 Leman Street. I had ignored him. Ignored the fact that he was a 23-year-old foreign Jew from Whitechapel, just like Kaminsky. That he was described as extremely violent and dangerous. Ignored the fact that he was brought in by the police. Ignored my knowledge, gleaned from a House of Lords Committee report in 1888, that unskilled Jewish immigrants in Whitechapel were always given employment in bootmaking or tailoring sweatshops, and those trades only. Ignored the obvious deduction from Leather Apron's disappearance when the search began, that he must have changed his identity, and probably the job that would have linked him with his apron. If he was unskilled, he could have become a tailor. This man could be the Nathan Kaminsky of March. Whence his name, David Cohen? Well, his case notes all described him as incoherent. Nathan, in the nasal accents of Jewish Whitechapel, might easily be heard as David. Cohen? The man was raving when arrested. Might he have slurred the name so that only the first syllables were misheard? And that raving illness itself offered a clue to Major Griffith's mysterious placing of the homicidal mania after the crimes. Nobody helplessly out of control like Cohen, who attacked other patients if allowed near them, could have remained on the streets for more than a few hours. The raving mania for which he had been picked up by the police as a wandering lunatic was certainly of very recent duration, quite different from the secret compulsion which would lead him to stalk and kill women. Could his mind have blown, as heavier and heavier police patrolling impeded his capacity to catch victims unobserved? I thought so. Some psychiatrists agree that it is highly possible. The increasing gaps between the murders pointed to it. 1 week between the first and the second, 3 weeks between the second and the double murders, 6 weeks before Mary Jane Kelly's atrocious mutilation, another 4 weeks, and Cohen was found raving in or outside a brothel the police were raiding. As for the address, the directories showed it must be wrong. 84 Lehman Street was the Whittington Protestant Boys Club. No Jew would have stayed there. But next door, at number 86, was the temporary refuge for poor homeless Jews. A perfectly likely place for the police to arrange to have a dangerous lunatic with no known friends or relatives returned if the doctors released him as cured. Especially as it was only a few doors away from the main Whitechapel police station. I was sure I had found the Ripper. I completed my manuscript and sent it off. In March 1987, when the proofs came back to me, my editor remarked that there was room for an appendix if I wanted to add anything. I decided to add every single detail I could find on David Cohen and sent for the Coney Hatch admissions and discharge book. And there, staring me in the face, was Aaron Kosminski, Polish Jewish hairdresser of Sion Square, Whitechapel, exactly the same age as David Cohen, sent to the asylum in 1891. I had missed him because his incarceration was so late and because his family had accepted financial responsibility for him for some years, thus keeping him off the dockets of pauper lunatics. His first reported fit of insanity was 1885. He was said to be harmless, but I had to see the full case notes in the daybook to see if this really was Jack the Ripper. I telephoned Weidenfeld's and learned I had 1 week to find out and complete any rewriting necessary. I promised that I would pay for the reprinting entailed, and I waited the 24 hours necessary for archive staff to locate the uncatalogued daybook. And with Aaron Kosminski's case notes in front of me, I could see at once that he could not be Jack the Ripper. The regular reports described a harmless schizophrenic. He had auditory hallucinations, believing that instincts told him what everyone in the world was thinking and advised him never to accept food from anybody. So he picked up bread from the gutters and drank from standpipes. The lay witness to his mental state, one Jacob Cohen of Carter Lane in the City of London, had seen him doing so. His instincts also told him never to take a bath. Jacob Cohen reported that he was said to have taken a knife and threatened to kill his sister. He apparently didn't know anything about this first hand. It was not, in any case, a remarkable act of violence in the poor, overcrowded dwellings of Whitechapel. He had been treated in Mile End Workhouse Infirmary for a week in 1890, sent for treatment again in February 1891, and transferred to Coney Hatch within a week, remaining there until 1894, when he was transferred to Leavesden Asylum for Imbeciles. There he finally died of a gangrenous leg in 1919. Not a word on his records suggested any violent fantasies or delusions. The nearest he came to being violent was one occasion when he threatened to hit an attendant with a chair. He obviously didn't like being made to bath. But his general disposition was quiet and amenable to questioning, though his concentration on his instincts made communication difficult. He became increasingly withdrawn and almost catatonic until and after his removal to Leavesden. Not Jack the Ripper, as far as the medical testimony went. But crucially, not Jack the Ripper, because of the length of time he spent at large between the ending of the murders and his incarceration. 26 months in all, an impossibly long time for the compulsive killer who had wrought such havoc with the bodies of Catherine Eddowes and Mary Jane Kelly to have controlled his terrible urges. And no sadistic serial murderer has ever been known to undergo spontaneous cure. Furthermore, if he was Anderson's suspect, and the identification had taken place in the asylum, as Anderson said, then all reliance on Dr. Anderson's detective excellence in this case collapsed. Nobody could guarantee such an identification made 2 years after the event. It seems to be typical of the Ripper case that whenever you follow a really good historical trail, a nasty booby trap lies at the end. I had predicted that there must be a Kosminski in an asylum, and in the light of the best documents available, prophesied that he would be the most plausible suspect ever proposed. Now I had found him, and instead of rejoicing that I had traced Jack the Ripper, was right back where I'd been 5 months earlier, with David Cohen as the most probable Ripper, the only Jewish mental patient whose incarceration fitted the ending of the murders, a man whose identification could have taken place just 7 weeks after a witness had seen him at Mitre Square, when that witness's memory might have been sound. Indeed, if the witness was Lavender, his identification seemed to me likely to be very good indeed, for Lavender had honestly said he'd not looked that closely at the man and did not think he would recognize him again. Lavender was a man who was not seeking any publicity, quite the reverse. If he instantly identified the man he had seen, his word would seem very reliable. And he had the social status to stand up to policemen urging him to give them a sworn statement. Lavender is still the only positively known Jew to have seen the murderer's face while he was with one of his victims. Of course, Israel Schwartz was sufficiently Jewish-looking for Abilene to have assumed the cry of Lipsky was directed at him, and he was very likely a Jew. But as a young and recent immigrant communicating through an interpreter, it seems totally unlikely that he would have had the courage to resist urgent police demands that he sign a statement. It would, moreover, be out of character with the very forthcoming interviews he gave both Abilene and the Star, despite the language barrier. Recent attempts to suggest that Schwartz was more probably Anderson's witness than Lavender seemed to me puzzling and unpersuasive. With the book published, I began to meet other Ripper writers. Richard Whittington Egan's encouraging voice over the telephone and his distinctive compact handwriting were already familiar. But before meeting him in person, I met two new authors, the young actors Martin Howells and Keith Skinner. Their book, The Ripper Legacy, argued for Druitt as the suspect. They were a little depressed because Melvin Harris, whom they had met at joint interviews, had left them believing that Richard had endorsed his quite different solution to the case, and Richard's standing among crime historians is very great. But they had misconstrued Melvin. Richard indeed thought his book one of the few likely to prove of any value among the centenary offerings, but he did not think his identification of the Ripper carried any weight. Not that I agreed with Howells and Skinner's conclusions. I liked them immensely, as does practically everyone who meets them. They're outgoing, friendly, entertaining, and dryly witty. But their argument that Druitt had killed prostitutes because his mad mother had been accidentally infected with syphilis and was thereafter murdered himself by fellow homosexuals who feared an outbreak of homophobia if he were caught and convicted was entirely speculative and extremely implausible. The book was readable and exciting, but its conclusion didn't take us forward in the study of the Ripper case. Today, Keith himself is the first to admit that they produced no proof central to their mountain of speculation, just facts around the edges. But their starting point was soundly historical, McNaughton's opinion, and one section of their book was enormously impressive. They had searched resolutely for the alleged Australian pamphlet, The East End Murderer, I Knew Him, in which Daniel Farson believed Lionel Druitt to have accused his cousin. Farson and Colin Wilson had both carried out unsuccessful investigations in Australia. From England, by letter and telephone, Howells and Skinner established extremely persuasively that this document was apocryphal, combining misrecollections of an alleged confessional statement by the murderer Deeming and a special number of the local paper in a town where Lionel Druitt lived. It was a brilliant piece of dogged research, and I drew Richard Whittington Egan's attention to it, fighting down his inclination to dismiss a book which proffered such an unconvincing conclusion. Shortly after this, I met Melvin Harris when Pete Murray interviewed us jointly on LBC Radio. Melvin has an established reputation for exposing hoaxes and frauds, particularly of a psychic or otherworldly nature. He had discovered that a great many hoaxes entered the Ripper field, and the valuable part of his book exposes these. But unfortunately, he put up a solution of his own, the self-styled Dr. Donston, the black magician, who was really named Robert Donston Stevenson. Melvin established that some of Stevenson's self-inflating claims were true. From this, he made the doubtful assumption that all his other claims were true. And then he went through the most remarkable and unhistorical contortion to look for the Ripper. He listed all the suspects he'd heard of and drew up a table of things he assumed to be prerequisites of the murderer. He wanted a middle-class demeanour to reassure prostitutes, residence in Whitechapel, sufficient physical strength to carry out the murders, a possible modicum of medical skill. And at the end of his list, Donston Stevenson uniquely satisfied every single requisite. It would be a little more convincing if any other criminologist agreed with his psychological profile, which actually varies quite wildly from the generally agreed predictable characteristics of the Ripper, as assessed by those with adequate information and no axe to grind. I'm not, of course, counting myself. Melvin's answer to the necessary historical question, why did the murders stop, was even worse. He speculated that Stevenson underwent a sudden religious conversion, which led him to abandon killing and devote himself to work on the mighty book on the patristic gospels, which he published in 1904. Since that was 16 years after the murders, and in the course of those years, Stevenson had been associated with theosophists, occultists, and black magicians, it is not surprising that Melvin's solution is generally seen as only less fantastic than the Joe Sickert or Duke of Clarence stories. And Keith and I were less than flattered when he produced a second book on the Ripper and addressed himself to our books with some logic chopping and speculation, which he called treating our research with the same respect he brought to his own work. All in all, I regret that I know Melvin through his professional work on the Ripper and not through his world-class amateur standing as a Baroque musicologist. By now, I'd put the Ripper behind me. I didn't expect to write any more about him again. I was busy researching the body-snatching trade for my next book. And coming out of the British Library one midday, after delving away among the gangs of sack-em-up men, I called my answering service to be told that the Daily Telegraph wanted me to call them urgently. When I did, I learned that a new and important Ripper document had turned up. And when the Telegraph consulted Donald Rumbelow, he told them they would have to talk to me, as the only person who knew about that area. Chief Inspector Swanson's notes had emerged, and according to the Telegraph, they supported my conclusions. When they dictated the notes down the phone to me, I could see that they didn't. They pointed in the same direction, but they were yet another booby trap at the end of what seemed undoubtedly the right trail. Swanson had written his notes in the margins and on the back pages of his copy of Anderson's memoirs, where Anderson concluded that the only person who ever saw the murderer unhesitatingly identified the suspect the instant he was confronted with him, but he refused to give evidence against him. Swanson continued in pencil, confirming what Anderson had previously said in the serial version, because he was also a Jew. But then Swanson branched out on his own, writing, and also because his evidence would convict the suspect and witness would be the means of murderer being hanged, which he did not wish to be left on his mind. Now, this contradicted what Anderson had said in Blackwood's magazine, that the suspect had been identified in an asylum, for a certified lunatic would be unfit to plead and could not be charged, let alone hanged. The contradictions got worse. Swanson seemed far from certain that the suspect had been positively ascertained to be the Ripper, as Anderson claimed, for he went on to say, and after this identification, which suspect knew, no other murder of this kind took place in London. Well, this reduced the circumstantial evidence against the suspect to that which we knew to hold good for Druitt. The murders stopped when he could no longer commit them. But Swanson's support for Anderson deteriorated further, as he proceeded to tell a most unlikely yarn.
After the suspect had been identified at the seaside home, where he'd been sent by us with difficulty in order to subject him to identification, and he knew he was identified. On suspect's return to his brother's house in Whitechapel, he was watched by police, city CID, by day and night. In a very short time, the suspect, with his hands tied behind his back, he was sent to Stepney Workhouse and then to Coney Hatch and died shortly afterwards.
Now, Swanson could not be lying. This was a private memorandum made in his own book for his own satisfaction. It was Swanson's habit in his retirement to annotate the margins of his books. What Swanson described
he believed he remembered happening. Yet his story was outrageously implausible. A man so seriously suspected that the Metropolitan Police undertook a difficult operation to take him for identification was positively identified by a reliable witness. But when the witness refused to testify, the police meekly let the villain go, instead of charging him, subpoenaing the witness, and forcing the witness to say under oath what he had seen. This is completely different from Anderson's plausible story of a certified and unchargeable suspect being identified by a witness who then refused to give a sworn statement confirming his identification. And Swanson's story grows wilder by the minute, as he implies that the Met were satisfied that their man would never repeat his offences, having been identified, and left the city police to keep watch over him on metropolitan territory. I don't think any policeman anywhere who has seen these notes has ever found that claim believable. Yet there it is, in Swanson's unmistakable handwriting, representing his recollection of whatever Anderson was talking about 22 years after the event. In his last terse comment, Swanson shows that however it came about, he was mistaken somewhere in his recollection. "Kosminski was the suspect," he wrote. Aha! Not if he died shortly after going into Coney Hatch, as Swanson's notes claimed. For in 1910, the earliest date at which Swanson could have written this personal memorandum, Kosminski had been in an asylum for 19 years and had another 9 years to live. And yet... Swanson referred to the suspect being watched at his brother's house in Whitechapel. And Aaron Kosminski was unique in the Coney Hatch registers as a patient whose address was his brother's house in Whitechapel. Charles Nevin of the Telegraph arranged to meet me a couple of days later at the Greater London Archives, where I could guide him through the asylum registers and he would show me the original marginalia. And he suggested that I talk with Donald Rumbelow, who had first been shown them. So I telephoned round City of London police stations, finally catching Sergeant Rumbelow just coming off duty at Bishopsgate. He sounded delighted to hear from me and instantly suggested that we meet at Wood Street Station to talk over the notes in the canteen. Don Rumbelow is the sort of big, friendly, reassuring personality that has given the British police a good name. Flatteringly, he was aware of my other books. He had expected, when he saw I'd written on the Ripper, that this would be what I had indeed originally intended, a lively coffee-table book. He was astonished to find a dense book with no illustrations except detailed maps of the murder sites. I could return the compliment. I had read all his books. Indeed, no serious crime historian could have failed to. And then we talked non-stop for 3 hours about these mysterious marginalia from Swanson without getting any closer to a solution. From his experience as a policeman, Don made a couple of points that wouldn't have occurred to me. He wasn't surprised that the city police kept watch on a house in the Metropolitan Territory of Whitechapel. In a case as notorious as this, it would be commonplace for either force to tread quietly on the other's territory, hoping for the prestige of solving it. But he was puzzled by Swanson saying the suspect was taken with difficulty for identification. In a case as notorious as this, there would be no difficulty in taking a suspect to the moon if it looked promising. The seaside home baffled him. The term was commonly used for the police convalescent home at Brighton. But that didn't open until 1890. And neither Swanson nor Anderson could command much respect if they placed any credence on a single witness's identification 2 years after the event. In fact, the whole idea of thinking that a single witness's identification of a suspect could amount to positively ascertaining the murderer's identity aroused Don's professional contempt, both as a policeman and a crime historian. He was, and is, still less inclined than I am to think that there must have been some valid reason for the suspect to be taken for identification in the first place. But we could reach no useful conclusion. And Don ended our conversation with the remark, "All I can say is it proves Kosminski existed, and he wasn't Jack the Ripper." "But Don," I protested, "I've already written a book saying just that." It wasn't until I'd slept on it that an explanation of the most puzzling points in the Swanson marginalia occurred to me. My mind had been concentrating on Kosminski, the man named. I hadn't given serious thought to David Cohen, the man I suspected. But the two bewildering things Swanson said that were quite wrong about Kosminski could apply to David Cohen. It was in the last degree improbable that Kosminski, a harmless schizophrenic, taken for treatment by his own family, would have been led to the infirmary with his hands tied behind his back. But Cohen's records explicitly said that he was brought to Coney Hatch under restraint, and further noted that the first thing he did on arriving was to throw himself down on the floor, which indicated that the restraint pinned his hands and arms. And Cohen had indeed died shortly after transfer to Coney Hatch. In fact, subsequent re-examination of the records would show me that he was the only Jewish patient in this period who died prematurely. Far from overturning my theory that David Cohen was the suspect and Kosminski's name had been dragged in by mistake, the Swanson marginalia actually supported it. But how could it have happened? Here, Donald Rumbelow's observation about the two forces working covertly in competition with each other helped. Swanson said the city police watched the suspect's house in Whitechapel, and there could be no doubt that was Wolf Cohen's house in Sion Square. Conversely, Swanson and Anderson independently said the identifying witness was Jewish. Now, the one Jewish witness we could definitely say some policemen believed was the only person to have a good sight of the murderer was Joseph Lavender. But those policemen were city police, and Lavender was a witness to the crime committed on their patch. Could this be confirmation of my suspicion that McNaughton and Griffiths' mysterious reference to a city PC who had seen the murderer was a garbling of the city police witness who had seen the murderer? And could it also be that the Met, the we who carried out the identification, had hijacked this witness, hoping for the prestige of proving that they had incarcerated the Ripper, only to have their hopes dashed when he refused to confirm his identification? If they had done this, they would certainly not have told the city or anyone else of their dodgy and unsuccessful pursuit of the claim to have caught the Ripper. Bearing in mind that Swanson must have remembered something when writing his notes, and that it was utterly implausible that he should casually have taken his eye off such a dangerous criminal as long as he lived under the care of doctors who might release him as cured at any point, it seemed he must have remembered the Ripper dying. When Cohen died, the case was pushed out of sight and out of mind. But then, after Kosminski's incarceration, something must have leaked back from the city to the Met about the watch the city kept on Kosminski's house. And the Met assumed this referred to the young Central European Jew of the same age whom they had incarcerated and knew to have died. They had never been sure of their man's name. He'd been a raving maniac and unable to express himself coherently when they picked him up. But the city, as Donald Rumbelow pointed out, could have had no doubt at all. They knew of the man's address and sane brother, and so established that the family was called Kosminski. Without giving the matter further thought, the Scotland Yard chiefs noted the name in their minds, with other odd details about him, as matters of academic interest now that he was dead. But of course, Kosminski was another, though similar man, and still lived. I put this to Charles Nevin when we met the following morning, and he showed me the precious marginalia and accompanying letter from the Assistant Commissioner's office putting Swanson in charge of the case. He agreed that it explained the major problems and was the most plausible solution ever proposed. "Not that you're in a field notable for plausible solutions," he remarked. But he regretted that his editor would never print it, as the paper was content to have a name put forward by a contemporary and intended to propose that Kosminski was the Ripper. Donald Rumbelow, too, objected. "The solution to the documentary contradictions must be less complicated," he says. "Now, I approve of Occam's razor as much as anybody else. The truth will normally be the simplest explanation. And I challenge Don or anybody else to put forward an explanation of the documents which is simpler and explains the contradictions. I shall immediately accept it as preferable if those two conditions are satisfied. But no one has as yet attempted it." Nonetheless, I was about to encounter a new crime historian who will always have a central place in Ripper studies. I was telephoned by Paul Begg, whom I'd never met. He explained that he was writing a book which did not intend to identify the Ripper, but which was to carry more historical background than any other and support the data with proper footnotes. He had found important reports in newspapers nobody else had looked at, like the Western Mail and the Manchester Guardian. He had traced descendants of Inspector Abilene. He'd employed professional researchers to hunt for Kosminski and Ostrog in the asylums, but they had reported back that the two were not there. He believed that my solution was right, but was anxious to see the Swanson marginalia and wondered whether I could introduce him to the owner, Jim Swanson. I was cautious. To start with, Paul, whom I'd never met, stayed talking on the telephone for nearly an hour. His marathon telephone conversations used to be notorious, as he was accustomed to doing so much research over the phone. Then I'd been in correspondence with Mr. Jim Swanson, and I didn't want him unnecessarily badgered by some person unknown. Mr. Swanson and his twin brother had inherited their grandfather's papers on the death of their maiden aunt in 1980. Among the notes in the various books, they came across the old man's identification of the Ripper and immediately offered it for publication to the News of the World, which paid them £75 and sent a reporter to take details. But then, it seemed, the newspaper decided it was all 100 years old and there was no point in printing anything. Mr. Swanson believed he could not offer it anywhere else since he had accepted money for the information. Until, in 1987, he read a review of my book and the other new work on the Ripper, and noted a baffled reviewer concluding that all crime historians were at odds with each other and the mystery was clearly insoluble. Mr. Swanson decided he must publicise his historical information and obtain permission from the News of the World to offer it elsewhere. I did not want an old gentleman of his manifest integrity to suffer persecution by people trying to undermine his document. I'm afraid I was dilatory about approaching him on Paul's behalf. And in fact, Paul obtained the introduction he wanted through Keith Skinner, with whom he had established a working relationship by the time he came south and we met for the first occasion. This was an exploratory interview with the Los Angeles television company Cosgrove Mura. They specialise in solving mysteries on the screen and were following up a suggestion from Bill Eckert, head of the Milton Halpern International Institute of Forensic Sciences, that they get the FBI to do a psychological profile of the Ripper and compare it with the principal known suspects. They were trying to interview everybody who'd ever written a book on the case. Paul, Keith and I were interviewed together in a comfortable West End hotel one afternoon, an interview that became a wonderfully complex argument between Paul and me, for he had by now changed his mind about accepting my theory. He had discovered that Mr. Lavender's friend Mr. Joseph Hyam Levy had sponsored the naturalisation of a furrier named Martin Kosminski, and suspected that this meant he really did, as one newspaper suggested, know more than he would reveal. In short, he thought Levy must have recognised either Martin or a relative of his at Church Passage, and so Levy was Anderson's witness, and Kosminski was his suspect. This made nonsense to me, because I could not and do not believe that Swanson could conceivably have casually assumed his suspect had died in captivity while he was still alive. Paul's speculative explanation that he might have thought the transfer to Leavesden and his disappearance from Coney Hatch meant he had died did not persuade me for one moment. Nor was I over-impressed with the weight Paul put on the suggestion that the seaside home must be the police convalescent home in Brighton, wherefore the identification of the Ripper took place after Cohen was dead and could not involve him. If Swanson was correctly remembering the same incident as Anderson described, which I doubted, it seemed to me probable that there was another place or places in use for police convalescence before 1890. In fact, we now know from the records of the relevant committee that this is the case, and various seaside homes had been used since 1887. And finally, I could not accept Paul's belief that the sheer implausibility of Swanson's story made it more likely to be true, since he, of all people, would have known what a strange history he was relating. Some failure of the old man's memory still seems to me far simpler and more likely than that he should imperturbably record a correct tale of casually releasing the worst murderer of his career with a warning. In the course of our discussions, Paul observed that he was sure I would agree that he and I were in the presence of a researcher compared with whom our own work paled into insignificance. I hadn't a clue what he was talking about. Today, I have seen and worked with Keith Skinner's amazing, well-indexed files on the Ripper, his massive collection of photocopies, transcripts, and letters from descendants of prominent people. Keith's files hold the data on the suspect, Granger, and the alarming possibility that Anderson's witness was still witnessing 7 years after the event. Keith's collection showed that Dr. Dutton was not in himself unnecessarily unreliable. It was the filtering through McCormick that looked suspect. Keith established that there were remote links between the McNaughton family and the Druitts. Today, I wouldn't ever venture a new suggestion on the case without consulting Keith. Soon after this, Paul and I went to a conference in Italy, where we both met Daniel Farson for the first time. Dan clearly assumed that the old-style Hunt the Ripper race game rules still applied, and we would each hold our cards close to our chests and claim that we had solved the case and the others were wrong. I think he felt Paul and I were ganging up on him when we insisted that we were sharing information and avoiding repetitiousness in our papers. But I think also he was relieved to find that this did not mean putting down his work. Rather, we acknowledge him as the researcher who first made the search seriously historical. And while we thought the Polish Jew solution, our point of convergent agreement, was the most probable, we didn't think the case against Druitt had been disproved. The Polish Jew solution, indeed, proved most acceptable to the FBI and the panel of experts assembled by Crosgrove Muira when their program came out. Paul was its chief historical consultant, drawing on Keith's files as well as his own. Donald Rumbelow and I appeared on it, and the makers apologised to us for the fact that with their graphics prepared and the outrageous Clarence and Gull theories to be examined, they could not go into the complexities of David Cohen. I didn't mind their using the name Kosminski, provided I could make it briefly clear that I didn't think this correctly named the Polish Jew identified by Anderson's witness. In the event, the panel unanimously agreed that Kosminski was the only plausible suspect, though some of them definitely meant David Cohen, and others thought the case was far from proved. Since then, cooperation has remained the watchword. Paul, Keith and I have worked together and exchanged information with Donald Rumbelow and Richard Whittington Egan as soon as it came to hand. Paul and Don traced two separate manuscripts by Abilene, which record or refuse to record his memoirs. Neither, alas, said a word about the Ripper case. Don found a copy of Major Smith's memoirs, in which a friend of the old policeman had left notes confirming my conclusion that he was totally unreliable. Paul traced David Cohen's arrest and appearance at the magistrate's court, proving that the Met were indeed uncertain about his name, as they called him Aaron Davis Cohen in the morning and David Cohen in the evening. Most excitingly, Paul and Keith discovered the missing historical suspect, Ostrog. He was nothing to do with Pedachenko or Konovalov. He was an upmarket sneak thief and confidence trickster. The police sought him in 1888 for failure to report on ticket of leave. He was at that time in his 50s, and apart from once pulling a pistol on an arresting officer and once attempting to commit suicide, there was no trace of violence in his record. As in Druitt's case, McNaughton left us with the puzzling question, how did this man ever come to be suspected? A question which is not, let us note, a disproof of his guilt. If answered accurately, it might prove Swanson and Anderson to have been wrong. So that is where the case stands at present. All subsequent attempts to prove cases that move far away from the McNaughton memoranda and the Swanson marginalia have discredited themselves by the irresponsibility with which they try to get rid of this vital police evidence. Other excellent work continues. A surgeon called N.P. Warren, for example, has reopened the question of the Lusk kidney by showing that the kidney remaining in Catherine Eddowes's body did have Bright's disease, just as Major Smith, of all people, had reported. But today, the people best qualified to know about Jack the Ripper agree that only the lines of inquiry along the police investigation and medical reports are producing satisfactory historical results. Donald Rumbelow feels that these are still too confused to be likely to be the truth. Robin O'Dell, like N.P. Warren, thinks that recurrent statements that the knife was used confidently should leave medics or slaughtermen in the frame. Richard Whittington Egan thinks it is obviously likely to be one of the foreign immigrants who populated the district, but regrets that no final case seems to have been made against any. Keith Skinner looks to the Polish Jew as the most probable murderer, but wants more evidence before committing himself to any named suspect. Paul Begg thinks that the twice-named Kosminski must be the most likely suspect and the centre of research, while conceding the problem of his 2 years at large after the murders. And I annoy all my friends and associates by continuing to insist that Jack the Ripper almost certainly was the man incarcerated by the Metropolitan Police under the name David Cohen, who most likely was also the man using the name Nathan Kaminski earlier in the year.